On October 31, 2011, the United Nations Population Fund announced the birth of the 7th billionth person. Although just an estimate, the number is still the subject of much debate. Irrespective of differing numerical calculations, one thing for sure that the census agencies all seem to agree upon is that the population is somewhere over 6.5 billion people. That's a lot of people. And when you have over 6.5 billion people on one small planet all vying for that one thing of varying interpretation we identify as success, or even the representation thereof, something we all just can't have, there's bound to be a whole lot of hate for those who do obtain it. This is not the kind of hate born of bigotry or prejudice, but good old-fashioned, green-eyed begrudging, why do you have to have it and I can't? Why do you always have to win? I know you're hot, but I refuse to acknowledge it. Sour grapes, backstabbing, backbiting, tear you down because you're on top, celebrate when you fail, solicitous type hate. Yep, hate, H-A-T-E, the heightened ability to envy. The type of hate that only a hater can have.
We're talking about Tyler Perry at this point.
It's coonery and buffoonery. And I know it's making a lot of money. Bought his own jet.
Why doesn't he show his birth certificate? Why doesn't he show his birth certificate?
The state of Hawaii released my official long form birth certificate.
We have to look at it. We have to see, is it real?
There is extensive security here, but you don't want to see some wacko run out of the corner or items being thrown.
Does it bother you that so many people are happy to see you fail?
I just go out there and do my best. I accomplish one of my dreams.
Why? I'm sure there's others, because this kind of thing has happened before.
You have to take some responsibility for this.
How much responsibility do you think I need to take?
Haters. Who are they? What are they? What goes through their minds when they can't win or they just can't have what you have? What pushes them to hate and despise those who do well? What, where, and who does hate come from? Is hate contagious? If so, how does one even acquire it? Our hate is dangerous? What are the long-term effects of hate? Can it be treated? I hit the streets in earnest to find out.
Hate. You wouldn't believe it. It's coming from cat poop.
I think it just comes from people. It's hereditary. It's in their genes. They can't help it. So what are you gonna do?
Hate comes from cat litter. Toxoplasma, Gandhi, Gandia. I don't know, but it comes from cat litter.
I've been hated on, and I've been a hater too. And what I think it comes from is a lot of deep-rooted insecurities.
Cat litter, cat poop, scooping up stuff, getting in your fingernails, causing you to be crazy.
People insecure about their own looks, their own ambitions.
It's making people go crazy.
And then they latch on to other people and try to draw from them.
I'm that hater. I am that hater.
My search brought me bits and pieces of interesting information, especially the whole bit about cat litter, which kind of bothered me because I used to own a cat, but it just wasn't enough. I needed more information. And having deduced that hate has emotionally based roots, it would have to be something somewhat psychological, right? Right. So I hit up the psychology departments of various colleges and universities to find some experts that I hoped would know something. But no one would talk. And for some strange reason, everyone seemed paranoid and nervous. I didn't begin to understand what was going on until I encountered a faculty member at one university in particular and received a stark warning.
Hi, I wanted to ask you about hate and haters.
Man, there's haters here. It's not safe.
Wow. You gotta go. You gotta go.
I just wanna ask you a question. I just wanna ask you a couple of questions.
You gotta leave now. First, they'll have my job. Then they'll come after you. I'm not kidding.
Oh, come on.
No, you gotta leave. You gotta leave now.
I just wanna ask you a question.
No, you can't ask any question. Don't you know? There's hate. They're everywhere. There are haters everywhere. Come on. Go. Get the hell out.
Let me ask you a question. Shit.
What are you guys doing? Is that the new Canon camera?
Yeah, it's a little something.
Pretty chip, right?
Yeah, it's a little something.
That's that high-end camera.
That's what people say. I mean, it's all right, though.
It is.
Oh, all right. I guess so. You know?
Well, I dabbled in film and video.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. But even with all the overtime I put in here, I can't afford anything like that.
I'm sorry you could afford it. You know, it's not a big deal.
Apparently, I'm not making them big bucks like you.
I'm not making big bucks, you know?
I think you are.
I don't think I am. I don't think I am. I'm really not.
So you think you're some kind of big shot now?
No, I didn't say I was a big shot.
You guys going somewhere? In a rush?
I mean, not quite, but, you know.
I want to talk. How about you guys interview me?
Nah, that's all right.
Where are you guys going?
Just got things to do, you know?
You know what? The camera's a piece of shit, and so are you. Hope your fucking camera breaks.
Wow. You don't have to say, you don't have to be like that.
What? I don't have to be like what? What, you think you're better than me now?
I never said I was better than you, but
huh?
You don't have to be that way.
Fuck your camera, motherfucker, and fuck you!
Same.
I should have taken the warning seriously, because I could have gotten hurt. So I got out of there as fast as I could. But as shaken as I was from the ordeal, I was still undeterred. I needed answers. And I was lucky enough to find some at Emory University, where I found a brave psychologist willing to talk about hate, haters, and hating. She introduced me to some other knowledgeable doctors as well. How deep is the rabbit hole of hate? Deep. Really deep.
Hate and haters have been around for a very, very long time. And this goes back to the days of Jesus. Sweet baby Jesus. Yes. Sweet baby Jesus was hated on from the very beginning. And, I'm sorry. Praise the Lord. But see, this is where people really began to take notice. This is where identifiable manifestations of hate were first recorded. Think about it. Sweet baby Jesus. He's healing folks. He's walking on water. He's making it rain with rice out of the sky. The fish, the bread, the water into wine, raising the dead. All the hate he got, what we're seeing today, oh, this goes back centuries. Now see, from what we understand thus far, it is believed that hate starts in the blood. Now how it gets there, no one knows for certain, but what we do know is that the hate that's in the blood crosses the blood-brain barrier and affects the brain, the mind, and the hate literally drives the haters insane.
You can have hate in your blood, but that doesn't make you a bona fide hater until the brain is affected. Hate in your blood is just a result of initial exposure, but once the brain is affected, you become a hater. The hater in the hate is so potent that physiological manifestations begin to materialize. And at that stage, the hate, presumably from what we believe, becomes contagious.
Without the appropriate intervention via therapy or behavioral modification, because there is no clear-cut cure per se. We don't have a pill you can take for hate. A hater will keep on hating until the day you die or they die. The hate is relentless. Whether it's a new car, new shoes, a job promotion, a hairstyle, a marriage. Anything that is positive or successful for the next person, a hater will hate on. Why?
Because it feels good. Hate feels great. Now, successful hate, that really feels great. And we define successful hate as hate that produces misery, discomfort, failure, or embarrassment in the life of the hater's target, the hated. It releases endorphins in the brain, but only if the hating is successful. Haters are always looking for an endorphic high. That's why they love to hate. They want to get high. I mean, who doesn't want to get high? I'm sorry. You know what I mean. Endorphins are like drugs. It's a feel-good sensation for the haters, but only if the hating is successful.
If the hating is unsuccessful, if the hater's hate goes unabated, without satisfaction for an extended period of time, it can be deadly. The hate, in and of itself, won't kill the hater, usually, but it's the opportunistic conditions brought on by the hate that can cause fatalities.
Contagious, deadly, and incurable? Wow. I knew hate was bad, but I didn't know it was this bad. But guess what? It gets worse. I dug even deeper. In additional data I uncovered, courtesy of the Center for Emotional Control and the National Center for Emotional Health Statistics, revealed that 1 out of 4 of the total adolescent and adult population has hate in their blood. Yikes. It also revealed that approximately 1 out of 5 adolescents and adults can be classified as haters, meaning that the condition has spread to the brain. And lastly, more than 80% of the afflicted are either unaware of their condition or denied that they even have the condition despite symptoms. This is bad.
Who's bad?
Michael Jackson bad.
The symptomatology of a hater varies slightly from person to person, but overall, the telltale signs are pretty standard. There's anxiety, a general irritability or negativity towards the hated, an inability to focus on anyone else other than the person they're hating on, shifty eyes that can turn into staring, a scowl or permanently furrowed brow, mumbling or grumbling to themselves or others, tremors, which is shaking, and the most prominent symptom consists of expressions or explosions, dangerous fits of rage or outrage when faced with the hated person or persons who continue to do well despite the negative or hateful interventions by the hater.
Even though there's no known cure for hate in haters, it's a very manageable condition with the appropriate treatment, provided that a hater actually gets treatment, which is a very rare occurrence. You can definitely cure or correct the opportunistic conditions, the secondary conditions that hate can cause, if you act promptly. In many cases, acting promptly can save a hater's life. Hating causes strokes, seizures, dangerous spikes in blood pressure that can lead to hypertension, cardiac arrest via tachycardia, which is a rapid beating of the heart, proptosis, which is bulging eyes from constant hateful staring, constipation, and the inability to pass stool from constantly being upset and uptight because the hater involuntarily holds that stool in. And on the other end of the spectrum, fecal incontinence, which is the inability to hold stool at all because of the hater's desire to quote-unquote shit on who he hates is so strong at a subconscious level that he defecates on himself. So while skid marks in the underwear may sound funny, more often than not, it's a serious sign of the underlying condition that we identify as hate.
It is nothing more serious nor more heart-wrenching than hate hitting close to home. And if you ask Elizabeth Preston, she'll tell you that hell hath no fury like hate, where the heart is.
Julissa, she was like a sister to me. She lived next door and we grew up together, so when I lost her, it was the end of the world for me, you know? Because we were so close. It was the end of the world for me. I didn't lose her because of hate, not because she was hated on. I lost her because she was a hater. She became a hater when that rapper Nicki Minaj came on. Julie's a rap too. Julie's a rap too. And she was so angry that Nicki Minaj had a record deal and she didn't. She didn't even know Nicki Minaj, which I didn't even understand it. She would go to all the Nicki Minaj concerts and events and get front row seats just so she could hate Nicki Minaj, just so she could stare her down where Nicki could see her. But I don't think in a crowd that big, she could project that hate. Of course, you couldn't be the only person that a narcissist is focusing on. And I don't think her getting that hate through, I think it pushed Julissa over the edge. What hurts me the most is the fact that I never saw it coming. I wasn't paying attention. She wasn't hating on me, so I didn't think anything of it. I didn't know hate was gonna take her the way it did. So fast. We were at my mother's house watching the American Music Awards, and Nicki Minaj came on, and Julissa just had a meltdown when she saw the performance. I mean, it was a phenomenal performance, but she got so angry. I've never seen her get so upset. I remember her flying into a rage.
Turn it off.
She had a fit, cursing Nicki's name, saying all kinds of negative, envious, and nasty stuff, knocking things over. And before I could even try to calm her down, she lost her television set and her head. Her head went right through the TV screen as if Nicki Minaj were actually there. She was trying to tackle her in anger or something, and if my mother had that flat screen television, she had tried to get one on Black Friday from Walmart. But people were pepper spraying in the aisle. She never got it. Julissa wouldn't be here today. She wouldn't be alive today. But my mother had that all long body cathode ray tube television set with the rabbit ears. The kind that a child could have in. That's how big and wide the bag of it was. You could stash drugs in there, for God's sake, if you wanted to. So when Julissa threw herself at the TV set, in a rage, in a hater rage, she flew through that TV, head first, up to her waist. And that was it. I couldn't even pull her out. She had hate. She was a hater. And it killed her.
With the tragic and terrible demise of Elizabeth Preston's best friend Julissa, and the ever-present threat of a global and particularly pernicious pandemic on the rise, one has to ponder the possibility. Could Julissa's passing have been prevented?
Since there's no known cure for haters, the only practical approach, from what we understand thus far, is prevention through abstention, avoidance. Since we're unsure of the exact mode or mechanism of transmission, it's best to stay away from a hater, provided that you know who it is or who has it. That's the existential problem. It's not always obvious who our haters are, and that can make a situation downright dangerous, especially in terms of transmission. You don't always know with any certainty what's around you. Aside from that, preventative measures have proven to be a problematic area of study for us, because we're still trying to figure this thing out. And the first correct step in that direction is pinpointing exactly where hate comes from. It's been around for eons in a variety of forms, but we don't know where it comes from. Although there's a theory that's been gaining steam lately that hate originally came from bitches. Now, if hate came from a bitch and can come from a bitch, we're in a lot of trouble because bitches are everywhere. And a lot of people live with bitches. People really love their canine companions. They love their dogs.
Dogs? Hate might have come from dogs? As far-fetched as it sounds, I guess catching the flu from a bird or pig would sound crazy too, but it happened, right? Wow. With a new lead in my quest for information and answers, I decided to contact the Center for Disease Control, the good old CDC. Luckily, and to my surprise, a nervously whispering receptionist was actually brave and nice enough to point me in a more sensible direction. The local veterinarian's office. And she even gave me a name, Dr. Roberta Walters, veterinary pathologist and secret dog hate historian. Who knew? Dr. Walters invited me to her home to talk due to the fear of unidentified haters at work. Pragmatic precaution for perilous times.
Even though the research is still somewhat incomplete, the studies are ongoing. The data that's been gathered thus far strongly supports the hater phenomenon as a condition of zoonotic origin, meaning the condition began in animals and later crossed over to humans. In this particular case, we believe that hate began specifically within the canine species and then made that jump over to humans somewhere during the early period of initial canine domestication, roughly 15,000 years ago in the Middle East and or Asia. So, as the theory goes, there was a single dog owner who regularly gave leftover table food scraps to his or her dog. And that dog soon became accustomed to receiving what can only be described as a delicacy during that time period. The food was a delicacy because the dog was receiving prime portions that were not meant for canine consumption back then. But the dog became used to it and grew to expect it. Anyway, at some point, the dog owner acquired a domestic partner and everything changed. Those prime portions of food couldn't be wasted on a dog when there was now another human being present to eat with. So, those prime portions to the dog stopped abruptly. Long story short, the dog started getting inferior food portions, and that's where the hate began, with the dog watching its owners eat all the good stuff. Eventually, the dog snapped and bit them both. And shortly after that, we start seeing these human cases of hate, and later on, human-to-human transmissions of hate in the Middle East, Asia, that finds its way to the Americas and then around the globe. We don't know if dog-to-human transmission occurred before or after the bites. That transmission mode is still a mystery. But we do know that whatever hate that dog had died with it. That was the only dog who had it. Where it got it from? We don't know. But that's why they tell you not to tease or stare at dogs today. Despite the fact that dog hate to human hate transmission has not occurred since, that fear still persists amongst the general population. Silly humans.
I found Dr. Walter's hypothetical but highly plausible revelation to be nothing less than shocking. As a matter of fact, I found it to be downright disturbing. To think that dogs, man's best friend, started the seemingly incurable life and lifestyle-threatening scourge that's afflicting us today was absolutely mind-blowing. And with each bit of informational discovery, I found that the answers only bore more questions. Did the fear of dog-to-human transmission push NFL pro athlete Michael Vick over the edge in 2007? You just never know. Maybe he knew something we didn't about those dogs after all. Hey, I'm just saying.
I didn't know about the whole hate coming from the dogs thing. I had no idea. But from my personal experience with dogs, having observed them, it would make a whole lot of sense. I can definitely believe it.
I am familiar with that theory. I've actually heard of it and researched it myself. And no, no dogs in my house. They say there hasn't been a case of dog to human transmission in centuries, but you just can't believe everything you hear. They will tell you anything in order to prevent a case of mass hysteria, which I do understand to a certain degree, but you shouldn't withhold information that could potentially put people at risk. It's not right.
I don't believe there are new cases of hate coming from dogs.
People?
Absolutely. Dogs? No. But the theory of hate started with dogs? I believe it. From an evolutionary standpoint, dogs still harbor some small traces of hate, even though it's not transmissible. When I eat, I don't give Nibbles table food. And the look on his eyes when he's staring at me is unnerving. And on top of that, when I'm finished eating, I invariably find a pile of shit hidden in the house someplace. There's no excuse for a house-trained dog to do that. He's walked 4 times a day. So what do you call that? I call it hate. Yeah, hate. And if my dog had hate and it was transmissible, I would have had it by now. Regardless, when the dog goes, I'm getting me a cat. Because you never know, dog hate can come back.
It came from dogs? I would have never thought. I thought it came from Republicans.
Holy smokes!
I have 2 little dogs myself, you know. They're not hateful.
I don't think the origin of where it came from is very important if it's not coming from there anymore. What I think is important is transmission, because too many people around me are coming down with it, and I don't want that. I'm not even being hated on yet, thank God, but people who I think have it are coming to me like they want me to support them in their hate, and I don't want to be a part of that. I want to protect myself, but how do you protect yourself when you can't separate yourself? I work with these people every day. If I don't know how it's being transmitted, then I can't protect myself. I don't want to be a hater. I've seen what it does, and I don't want to hate. I don't want to be a hater. I have a family. I have a family. I'm sorry.
Hate. We kind of know what it is. And for the most part, we kind of think we know where it comes from. Sort of. And in most cases, we can identify who has it. Sometimes. As if the hate is hate reaches extraordinarily high levels, and or if the hate in an exposed person's blood reaches the brain. In either case, a hater can be pretty hard to miss. Sometimes. Which is why it's important to always remain vigilant. But the question now is, how is it transmitted?
I think people get it through saliva. Sharing food, drinks, utensils, stuff like that. Kind of scary. Very scary.
I think it comes from public restrooms. Toilet seats, toilet handles, faucet handles, finding things in the toilet. You see, this is why I can't use it. And if I have to, it's got to be really serious for me to want to defecate standing up. I'm not sitting in no public restroom. I hover. You know what I'm saying? Like, for real.
Haters have got a lot of things going on in their heads, so maybe where it's come from is starting from there. Maybe barbershops, beauty salons, places that deal with a head. Maybe that's where it's come from. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I cut my own hair.
Chemtrails. It's coming from chemtrails. Those jets that you see flying in the sky on a clear, bright, sunny day with the thick white smoke lingering in the sky for hours that looks like clouds, that's where it's coming from. And when it rains, it's coming down on top of all of us. It's driving people crazy. They want people to kill each other, man. And whatever it is that they're spraying up there, that's what it is. And it's coming out the sky like on some Night of the Comet shit. Go rent Night of the Comet. It's no joke. This shit is serious. It's not a game out here.
It's sexually transmitted. Definitely, you have to use protection. It's not always obvious who has it, you know? And you really have to watch a person for a while before you can make sure it's okay to hook up. But until you know for sure, mutual masturbation is safe. I think it's safe. I don't think you can get hate that way. I think.
For the most part, people have some pretty interesting ideas on transmission, but like myself, no one knew for sure. We're not the experts, and I definitely wanted to know because I was just as vulnerable and concerned as everyone else about catching it. And if you haven't been paying attention, I want to make it abundantly clear that hate is serious, and haters are dangerous. And now more than ever, an ounce of prevention, if it's even feasible, is worth a pound of cure. Enter dermatotoxicologist Dr. Brian Guevara.
When we think in terms of transmission, we typically defer to three modes of contraction: inhalation, ingestion, or absorption. In other words, what you breathe, what you swallow or absorb through your skin. And with this particular condition, the research is indicating that hate may be unconventionally airborne.
Airborne? Airborne? The man on the street said it. This is so not good.
Not your typical airborne inhalation, but a typical airborne dermal absorption through the skin via vapor penetration.
Chemtrails. It's coming from chemtrails.
Haters are excreting unidentified infectious substance and molecules through the perspiration or sweat that enters the atmosphere or immediate environment as vapor through the body's evaporative cooling process.
Go rent Night of the Comet.
The infectious vapor molecules in the air, through prolonged exposure to a hater, are absorbed through the skin and into the bloodstream. So the longer you hang around a hater, the more likely you are to get hate yourself. If the hater's hate, in and in itself, doesn't harm you first. We don't know why skin absorption works best for hate, but it does. And absorption through the membranes of the eye works even faster. That's why we don't stare back at a hater.
With that startling revelation, it was right then and there that I realized that this was a whole lot worse than chemtrails. This is so not good.
If you're staring, you're not blinking as often as you should to cleanse your eyes, which allows time for the substance that presumably causes hate to absorb or dig in. Hate substance that is ingested is destroyed in the stomach acid. So if you accidentally drink or eat after a hater, it's something you should not worry about. And hate substance that is inhaled doesn't propagate well in the lungs. The primary transmission comes through the absorption of the skin and the eye. So you should never stare at a hater. You should never hang out with a hater. You should not let a hater even touch you. It's very serious. If you know who they are, but you cannot avoid them, cover up. Long sleeve top, pants, long skirts seem to work best. It's not 100%, but it's effective. But the most important protection, above all, are shades.
and when I realized I didn't own a pair, made no mistake that I promptly purchased several. Seriously.
The membrane of the eye are so susceptible to hate substance absorption more than the skin is due to hater staring. If you cannot avoid eye contact with a hater, please put shades on. I've got some shades here. And as you can see, they are very dark shades. The darker, the better. It doesn't matter what brand they are. What is important is having a very protective contact barrier. If you're stuck with a hater and you do not have any shades at all and you cannot get to any, please close your eyes, look away, or simply walk away. It is the safest thing to have without having material protection.
Who would have thought that something as simple as shades could actually protect you from a hater? I found the whole phenomenon to be frighteningly fascinating, and with my newfound knowledge, I began to feel somewhat safer right away. But I also began to feel curious. What did celebrities know about this? And strangely enough, why do shades appear to be one of the ubiquitous hallmarks of celebrity? Is it just about looking cool or being fashionable? Or is it more about protection from haters?
Alright, so the majority of your celebrities wear shades for three reasons. To look fashionable, to shield their eyes from the bright sunlight and camera flashes, and yes, to protect themselves from haters. Protecting themselves from the eyes of haters is the number one reason why celebs wear shades. That's why you'll see celebrities wearing shades day and night. It's because of haters. Haters hate 24 hours a day, and celebrities are the biggest target for haters. So as a celeb, it's important to protect yourself from that, right? So do celebs know something that most people don't know about hate? Absolutely. They know. They don't willingly share the info with the rest of us, but for sure, they know. They're celebrities, so they're privileged to get information before the rest of us.
So there you have it, from a reliable entertainment industry insider. Celebs do know something extra about the hater pandemic, but if they knew how to protect themselves, what happened to the moral and ethical obligation to share this most serious knowledge with the rest of us?
I think celebrities, as the frontline receivers of hate, were always providing us with subtle clues as to how to tackle it, even though they didn't have all the answers. They could never be direct with it because you have to remember that they're surrounded by hate and haters on an intensified level. And the worst thing they could do in their position is to potentially enrage an unknown hater that may be within their very own circle that can harm them and their careers. Hello, the desolate one. Took a little time to claim my spot. Chairman of the board until this game stopped and I side with the Lord. If celebs are telling people how to protect themselves from hate, they're harming the hater agenda. And the hate, it just can't flourish. Haters don't like that. If you don't know how to protect yourself, it's easier for them to take you down. And that's what they want. But more so now than ever, people do need to know how to protect themselves. Because hate has gotten worse since Diddy and Mace put haters on blast and taunted them in the music and the videos of the 90s. That's why you see people with the gold crucifixes and the Jesus pieces around their necks. People are trying to protect themselves from haters. Physically, with the shades, and spiritually with the jewelry. Let me tell you, it's crazy out there.
And with soaring cases of hate, haters, and hating reaching unprecedented levels amongst the general population, the afflicted on both sides of the spectrum are increasingly turning to more than just shades and Jesus piece jewelry for prevention and protection. In some circles, the church is quickly moving to the forefront of the battle against hate with varying degrees of success, although critics continue to remain skeptical of the efficacy of the church's efforts.
The power of Christ compels you, you hater! Power of Christ! The power of Christ compels you! You hater! Stop the hating! Stop the hating! You stop that hate! Stop the hate! Pick her up! Pick her up! Stop the hate! Stop the hate! Shut up! You hater! Shut up! Be gone, you hater! Stop the hate! Hater! Hater!
Hate has been around for a very long time.
Shut your mouth and show yourself, you hater! You shut your mouth, you foul, hating hater, and show yourself, hater!
And it has managed to flourish because many who suffer from it, well, they deny it.
I'm not a hater.
Shut your mouth!
I'm not a hater.
Show them the hater!
Calm down.
But you shut your mouth, you foul-hating hater from hell! In the name of Jesus, you shut your mouth!
Those who are afflicted by it, the hated, well, they ignore it, hoping that hate's just going to go away. It does not go away, and it will not go away.
Nobody shut your mouth! The power of Christ compels you! You scratched your friend's brand new car because you're a hater.
I didn't scratch your car.
Yes, you did. It's because you're a hater.
Just listen. I didn't scratch your car.
It was no accident. It was because of hate.
Hate is evil. It's an evil thing. It's a spiritual thing. It's a hateful thing. And it has to be dealt with a spiritual approach.
You stopped going to lunch with your best friend at work all because she got a raise and you didn't. And you couldn't handle it.
I could.
Because you're a hater.
I'm a hater.
Yes, you are.
I'm a hater.
Do you want help?
Yes.
Now, there are those that would contend that hate is a physiological illness, and that may very well be. But it's my belief and my view that spiritual illness gives rise to physical illness. Therefore, you must address and you must defeat the spirit of hate first.
Help me.
Hater, come out. The power of Christ compels you. Hater, come out of this man and be gone. Be gone in the name of Jesus, be gone forever.
If you don't defeat a hater's spirit, then they're never going to recover. And that is why we have people like Newt Gingrich, Rush Limbaugh, Charles Barkley, NeNe Leakes, and Bill O'Reilly, who are getting worse and worse with each passing day because their hate is not being dealt with on a spiritual level. And until it does, until it is, their hate's not going to stop. A hater? A hater's going to hate.
And while some have turned to the church in their efforts to stamp out hate, others have turned to each other.
Hey, come on in. Gang's all here. I started Triple H, Help a Hater Heal. It was about 5 years ago, 2 years after I was diagnosed with hate. And I didn't even know that I had it at the time. But my sister, who knows me pretty well, she started noticing changes in me and recognizing symptoms. Like, I was angry all the time, and I had lost all my friends, and I couldn't stop crying or gnashing my teeth from watching other people win. I started having stomach and bowel problems from all the pent-up anger and resentment to the point where I had to wear adult diapers because I was soiling my underwear and my clothes from the fits of rage from watching the people that I was hating on succeed. The migraines, hypertension, the hate. I couldn't stop hating. It was killing me, and it was going to kill me. And I had to find a way to get it under control. And what I found is that the way to healing, to coping, it really lied in the fact of I had to be able to talk and relate to others like myself, other haters.
Welcome everyone and good morning. I'm Jessica Loving and I am
honored to be here with you, that you're sharing your time with me today. I feel like we can do a lot of good work because the hardest part of this process is getting you here. I am hopeful that we will have a successful session, and it's a special time for all of us. I want you to start breathing and really just try and relax. And let's start by closing our eyes. Everybody close your eyes. Put your hands on top of your head. Really try and relax and repeat after me. I am a hater.
I am a hater.
And I am here.
And I am here.
To control my hate.
To control my hate.
So I can stop hating. So help me, God.
I found that through peer group therapy and meditation that I am better able to control my hate and bring it down to levels that are virtually undetectable, which is an incredible thing because my hate was raging at really high levels and I couldn't hide it. That's how bad it was. But it's something that I still struggle with. We all struggle with day to day.
Let's keep our eyes closed and bring our hands down to our hips, start loosening up. Relax your muscles. Roll your shoulders a little bit. Take your head back and start rolling your head from right to left. Breathe, roll, and really try and relax. That's right. Now, I want you to think about all the people that you hate. I want you to visualize them in your mind's eye. That's right. Think about all those people. Now repeat after me. I am happy for your success.
I am happy for your success.
I am happy for you when you achieve.
I am happy for you when you achieve.
Peer group therapy, it's not a cure. It's just, it's a management method, and it can prolong a hater's life. And, you know, hopefully it can stop a hater from destroying the lives of others through hate. People who suffer from this, we go through a lot. It's a fight to try not to hate. And until we can ultimately win that fight, we have got to keep fighting. I am happy for you.
I am happy for you.
I want to see you win.
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 Breathe. You're here. It's okay. You're right here. It's okay. Control
it.
Control
it. They can't have it. No, it shouldn't.
No, listen. Listen, we're all going to wait. We're all going to listen. Listen to me. Look at me. Look. Eric. Look at me and breathe. I want you to breathe. You don't have to hate. You can control it. That's why we're here. We're here to control. That's right. Take a deep breath.
If I can control my hate, then I know that there's hope that others can control theirs too. I want to live. And I want to let others live. Having anger towards everyone reaching success, it's not the answer. When I look in the mirror, I don't want to say, "Hi, hater." I want to say, "Bye, hater."
In closing, whether you're the hater or the hated, and irrespective of who you decide to turn to for help, the power to curb this epidemic, this suburban scourge, this urban ulcer we call hate, lies with you. Use protection. Invest in prevention. Don't gloat to provoke. And maybe, just maybe, you'll help a hater to stop hating and heal.
As a contagious disease, hate has largely been ignored for a number of years, until recently when we started to see a correlation between violence and soiled underwear. There seemed to be some pattern that followed one after the other.
It's driving people crazy.
We began to try to examine the origin of hate and where it might have come from.
Chemtrails. It's coming from chemtrails.
As with most diseases, we used a study group of animals, canines, bitches, if you will, that we thought would set up the perfect scenario for studying transmission and origination of hate. It just seemed to be the logical conclusion based on what we had seen coming in through our doors. So we set up a beta group, one set of bitches here, another set of bitches on the West Coast, and we followed their pattern to see what kind of aggressiveness would come out of there, and if in fact they at times had fecal incontinence.
It's no joke. This shit is serious. It's not a game out here.
Correlation was unbelievable. It seemed to quite sync up with a set that would certainly soil themselves, were more aggressive. They came after the other dogs. So we set up another group and tried to work on that, trying to separate them, trying to calm the bitches from the other ones. And sure enough, fecal incontinence was cleared up almost instantly. We were able to monitor and control that. So now, based on that analysis, we're transferring the study over to humans and trying to get study groups of those to test out our theory on how we may be able to lessen the spread of hate through this country through less transmission, less diarrhea, and anything we can do to kind of soften the blow that has hit the society. Transmission seems to be the key. We just haven't necessarily figured out the exact link or mode.
You know, I'm really very glad we did have this chance and opportunity to talk because, I mean, hating does produce endorphins, but endorphins are good. You know, feeling good, there's nothing wrong with that. I was at Woodstock. I was high for 4 days straight. Being high is fabulous. Why not? And if you can get it naturally, it's perfect. You know, the real problem now is that it's illegal to get high unnaturally. Getting high with alcohol, really fine, because it's legal. Getting high with marijuana, not so fine. Because it's not legal. But you don't need to hate to get endorphins. Not an issue. Not endorsing it, mind you. Not an issue. Good for some people, not for everyone. Now, when a hater gets this high, They don't care if their hate is successful or not. Is that red light going? Are we really on camera?
Does it bother you that so many people are happy to see you fail?
Absolutely not. Because at the end of the day, all the people that was rooting on me to fail, you know, at the end of the day, they got to wake up tomorrow and have the same life that they had before they woke up today. You know, they got the same personal problems that they had today.
And certainly to track Osama bin Laden anywhere he can be found. I'm sorry, I can't quite hear you. You know, I think it's totally appropriate for the president to express to the American people the view that he has, that he had an important role in taking out Osama bin Laden.
Chemtrails. It's coming from chemtrails.
Sisters, show me know how.
Now tell me, can you feel?
In the sessions that I lead?
Yes.
You wouldn't believe what I've seen. I've seen anything from people being rushed to the hospital because they literally are having like cardiac arrest. I mean, the hate, it's like they're possessed, like a demon. I have seen people move to tears and almost become like in this hypnotic state where they're so at peace, which makes me feel really good when I can do that, but you know, typically the hate is so strong it just takes over their personality, and I feel very lucky when I can actually save someone. I've just seen people just go crazy. I've had fights. I've had people meet and start dating, actually. I mean, I've seen it all. I really, you know, it can work.
I've heard that you've also done some private sessions with celebrities and politicians. Like, who are some of the people you've had sessions with privately?
Privately?
If it's okay for you to do.
Well, I worked a little bit with Senator Edwards. And, you know, I think I got him feeling too good. Because then he starts, you know, the whole mistress thing. I mean, it comes out. I mean, he's like went from like hating to just loving everybody. Too much of it. He was kind of crazy. I tried. Let's see who else. Oprah sent me some people. You know, I worked a little bit with Barack Obama, and he's pretty good. I mean, he had a lot of like stress and anxiety and stuff from being president. And he didn't want to have the hate. He did not want to have the hate because he is trying to get us all together. And so I really helped him with this last campaign.
He was trying to block it out, basically.
I'm totally blocking it out. I mean, I did like a hypnosis session with him and everything.
He's getting a lot of that.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Tons of it. Yeah.
Wow.
You know, I'm trying to think of some of the celebrities. I mean, I worked with John Travolta. He's got a lot of rage right now. And him. You know, a lot of publicity on him. A lot of haters. Oh, my gosh. Like, I've had to teach him how to, like, shield it, block it, so he can remain happy.
Wow. So you kind of do both sides of the spectrum where, you help the haters and the hated.
Oh, yeah. Wow. I've done interventions. I mean, I go both, you know, both ways, both sides.
Do you think we'll find a cure for something like that?
You know, I do have hope. I don't know, not as much a cure as much as really, maybe there'll be a pill one day where you won't have to meditate as much. It'll just keep you in that meditative state. Mm-hmm. Kind of like a tranquilizer, but not as strong. But, you know, I think there's hope for that. Just, I don't want to sedate people. Mm-hmm. But I do have hope. And we got to do something. I mean, there's like wars all the time, and you know, we gotta get all on the same page. Yeah, it's bad.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm proud of what I started. I mean, it started way back. You know, my family and my sister was like always so pretty, and she, you know, I was always told like, you're the loser, you're this, you're that. You know, it started with my dad, like his granddad did it him. I mean, just like this family thing. And I couldn't take it anymore. So I think I've stopped a lot of people from committing suicide.
And they say that, you know, I guess because of these problems.
Because they just don't want to hate anymore. They just don't want to hate. They'd rather just die than keep hating. But then on the other hand, you know, they get off on hating. It's like a high. It's like a drug.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they're addicted to the rage.
And there's more of a demand for gastroenterologists because of some of the complications from this thing.
Yeah, that's kind of the embarrassing part, you know. I mean, the whole incontinence and having to buy diapers. And the cashier's like, oh, do you have somebody elderly at home? No, thanks for myself. I mean, really? Like... It's terrible, you know. Oh, why? Because I have pent-up rage. You know, it's just not, you know, it is a disease, but, you know, yeah, physically, it's just, it's unbelievable. I've been on a date before. Literally, I, like, about jumped out of the car. The guy thought I was crazy, but I just was so, couldn't hold it in. He had to take me home. It's terrible. It's embarrassing. I see you smiling. Don't even. Because it is